Welcome to today's session. Our focus will be a technical walkthrough on implementing the lumbar subpedicular approach for transforaminal injections alongside bilateral facet joint injections, primarily for patients experiencing chronic unilateral radicular pain. It's crucial to note that the purpose of the facet joint injections isn't to alleviate facet joint pain per se, but to relieve symptoms associated with stenosis. Therefore, I refer to this procedure as a Flavo injection. I adopted this term from the flavotomy. This exploration will be supplemented with a technical video for a hands-on understanding. Meet my patient, a 65-year-old male who has been under my care for approximately 3 years. He first consulted with me after experiencing left lower back pain radiating downwards, which began a year before his initial visit. He typically schedules appointments every 7 to 9 months, each time presenting with similar symptoms. Let's review his spinal MRI, conducted 3 years ago when he first reported pain. Before we describe the MRI grading details of our patient, kindly take a moment to review the table that elucidates how radiologists categorize disc degeneration from grades 1 to 5. It's better to understand that in grade 5, the MRI will showcase a homogeneous low signal intensity with the nucleus and annulus appearing indistinguishable from one another. T1 weighted sagittal images reveal significant findings. The mid-sagittal image displays advanced degeneration, grade 5, at the L2-3, L4-5, and L5-S1 intervertebral discs, with grade 4 degeneration noted at the L3-4 disc. A closer examination of the left parasagittal sectional image uncovers severe foraminal stenosis at L4-5, accompanied by subchondral low signal intensity and moderate foraminal stenosis at L5-S1. Meanwhile, the right parasagittal sectional image highlights mild foraminal stenosis. Turning our attention to T2 weighted sagittal images, the mid-sagittal sectional discloses diffuse high signal intensity in the bone marrow of L2, L4, and L5 vertebral bodies. Additionally, there's notable high signal intensity within the L4-5 and L5-S1 discs. Another key observation is the pronounced proliferation of fat within the anterior epidural space, spanning from the L4 body level down to the S1 level, leading to a narrowed thecal sac. The left parasagittal and far lateral images further unveil high signal intensity within the bone marrow of L4 and L5 bodies and the L5 pedicle. Significant foraminal stenosis at L4-5 and moderate foraminal stenosis observed at L5-S1 are evident. Upon reviewing the axial T2 weighted image at the L4-5 disc level, it's apparent that there is an increase in both anterior and lateral epidural fat. Combined with a thickened ligamentum flavum, it results in crowded nerve rootlets. Additionally, there's observable diffuse disc bulging and grade D severe central stenosis at the L4-5 level. Additionally, please familiarize yourself with the MRI grading systems for central and foraminal stenosis. Typically, central stenosis grading is based on axial T2 weighted images, while foraminal stenosis is conventionally assessed using sagittal scans. However, in instances where it's permissible, I opt for oblique sagittal scan images to guide the evaluation of foraminal stenosis. Clinical impression: the patient presents with grade D severe central stenosis at the L4-5 level. Concurrently, severe foraminal stenosis at left L4-5 and moderate foraminal stenosis observed at left L5-S1. Bone marrow edema is also evident within the L2, L4, and L5 vertebral bodies and the left L5 pedicle. For his treatment, I use a cocktail of Botox, 40 to 50 units triamcinolone, 30 mg 40% dextrose combined with optimal local anesthetics. The total volume of this mixture is approximately 3.5 milliliters. I inject 1.5 milliliters into the foraminal space, and for each facet joint injection, I administer 1 milliliter into each facet. See arm-guided left L5 subpedicular transforaminal alongside bilateral L4-5 Flavo injections. The patient underwent a transforaminal injection utilizing a left L5 subpedicular approach, supplemented with L4-5 Flavo injections. A step-by-step video demonstration of the process is provided for your detailed understanding. Our team meticulously adjusts the C-arm throughout the procedure, modulating its rotation and tilt to yield clear, stepwise images from needle manipulation to the actual injection. The procedure starts with adjustments to the C-arm to capture a view of the vertebral endplate. This adjustment is accomplished by delicately tilting the C-arm and securing a left ipsilateral oblique view. In this case, the opening window for the transforaminal injection isn't ideal due to mild vertebral body collapse, an inferior downward proliferation of the transverse process, and hypertrophy of the superior articular process of the S1. As a result, precise adjustments to the C-arm angle are imperative to maximize the opening of the intervertebral foraminal space. After having determined the needle trajectory, the procedure begins. Typically, the skin is punctured at a location inferior to the anticipated target area to avoid contact with the bone of the transverse process. Throughout the procedure, there's a switch between using long forceps and manual needle handling. This approach ensures both precision and safety during the progression of the needle. Upon achieving stable forward movement of the needle, the C-arm is transitioned to an AP view. Followed by a shift to the contralateral oblique view. The needle is then advanced cautiously and deliberately. To administer contrast media, an extended mini-volume tube is utilized. This approach allowed for the observed efficient spread of contrast media into the subpedicular root sheath and the epidural space. Following this step, the C-arm is repositioned to an AP view for observation. Subsequently, a syringe, pre-filled with a steroid mixture, is connected. The initial phase of this stage sees a slow and careful infiltration of the fluid mixture into the transforaminal space. Subsequently, attention is directed towards the inferior capsule of the left L4-5 facet joint. Although many practitioners conventionally aim for either the facet joint's mid-portion or its superior recess, my experience indicates that targeting the inferior recess is simpler, more precise, and quicker. The specific target here is situated inferiorly to the opening gap of the posterior joint line. Care must be taken during this procedure. Advancing the needle either too upward or too low relative to the joint line could result in contact with the bone of the L5 inferior articular process or the bony spur of the S1 superior articular process. Unlike approaches targeting the mid portion of the facet joint or its superior recess, the inferior approach might pierce through the ligamentum flavum or disperse the injectant into the ligamentous structures. This technique is sometimes called Flavo, short for flavotomy, although it doesn't entail an actual flavotomy. It is vital to understand that this enhanced injection technique's primary intention is not to alleviate facet joint pain per se. Rather, its main aim is to relieve subpedicular stenosis. Allow me to proceed with injecting 1 milliliter of the steroid cocktail. Here's a valuable tip: injecting a volume that is too excessive can exacerbate compressive symptoms. While this is not a concern in cases of mild central stenosis, it can induce unbearable pain in severe stenosis. Therefore, limiting the total volume to 1 milliliter is advisable to avoid this complication. Now, let's transition to the right L4-5 Flavo injection. The technique applied here mirrors that used for the left L4-5 Flavo injection. Typically, my target is situated more medially and inferiorly relative to the inferior articular process joint line, with the approach directed laterally and upward. There are instances where the opening of the inferior joint capsule is elusive. In such cases, I opt for the superior recess approach as an alternative. Utilizing the mid portion of the facet joint is a rare practice for me, reserved for unavoidable circumstances where it becomes the selected target. Once I feel the joint capsule, there's a distinctive pop as the needle enters the joint space. I will then connect the mini volume tube with contrast media, and you'll notice the contrast media linger in the opening area. The procedure concludes following the injection of the steroid cocktail. I have previously published results regarding the efficacy of bilateral Flavo injections of the cocktail for addressing central stenosis, comparing its effectiveness with that of bilateral transforaminal injections. The outcomes for the Flavo injections proved superior. Thank you for your attention today. I encourage you to implement this technique when treating patients who present with analogous symptoms and MRI findings. Incorporating this method into your practice will undoubtedly enhance your toolkit for pain management. Please look forward to additional insights and valuable tips in our forthcoming sessions.